This is Ham Radio Now, episode 281. Your repeater, your rules, and some other stuff from FCC Special Counsel Laura Smith's talk at Pacificon last October 2016, depending on when you're watching this video. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, the host here at Ham Radio Now. And you know, the title is almost clickbait. But she did talk about a lot of other stuff. And I'm going to play the whole thing here in a few minutes. But first, I will give you some headlines so that you know what's coming up. And I'm going to give you links in the YouTube description. That's, if you're watching YouTube, it's just down there someplace. If you're watching on a computer, not sure how well that works on a phone. I'll give you some links to each of those headlines so you can go right to the parts of her talk. And there are many parts in her talk, and you can get right to that. That's a lot of work. I usually don't do it because it's a lot of work. But I needed to put in something extra because I didn't shoot this video. This video came from this fellow down here, Bob Miller. And Bob, stop it. Bob is a WB6KWT. And he, along with his son Robert, KA7JKP, recorded this talk at the Pacificon convention on October 15th for their local club, the Mount Diablo Amateur Radio Club out there in California. And he stuck it on YouTube here as, you know, just kind of a plain vanilla. And there were a couple of audio problems. Bob had set the audio all up. He's worked in, you know, television and video for most of his career. He knew what he was doing, but there was some trouble apparently with the PA system in the room, and they cranked it up. You'll hear a little bit of that at the beginning of the talk. There was more, a little bit more reverb in it. There's some distortion. I cleaned it up as best I could. I think we can live with it, especially for the content that you're going to get from this. So I asked Bob for permission to do that cleanup and to repost it here, and he said, go for it. So thank you, Bob, and thank you, Bob's son, Robert. Appreciate that. Before we get to those details that I promised you, I need to point out Arvin here on the Ham Radio Now website. Get down to the bottom. There is Arvin. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So you go to our website, you click on Arvin, and you get to the contribution page. And I'm going to not talk about any more contributions because I want to go to the swag page because it's coming up on the holidays, Christmas, and you know, whatever you might celebrate. And there's some terrific stuff for the ham who has almost everything, but could use just a little bit extra stuff, especially if they're a fan of Ham Radio Now. So at the top, we got the clothing and the mugs. And let's see, I've got an example of some of the clothing right here. Ham Radio Now t-shirt. There's also a sweatshirt and hoodies. And then the mug. Where's the mug? It's behind me somewhere. Oh, there it is. It's sitting on a speaker, and it's covered up by the microphone stand. That's the mug. So we got those things, and then there's something else to point out. This is not my product, but it is a project that I worked on. It's the K1N Navassa Island de-expedition from last year. And I was the editor and I did the voiceover on that. And this is not just for DXers. This is an interesting program, good for just about anybody who'd be interested in ham radio stuff. And even if all you do is operate 2 meter FM with a handy talkie, I think you'd still be interested in watching this program. So stop by the Ham Radio Now website and go to the swag button. And that's it for the swag. Not a lot yet, but are we working on more? I don't think so. That may be it. Okay, one more thing, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. Now, the Parity Act has passed the House. And it has passed a Senate committee, and it is sitting there waiting for Senate approval. And if it does all that, goes to the president, gets signed. the Parity Act is no longer controversial, at least in theory, because it has been agreed to. Language, compromise language, has been agreed to by the opposition, which was the CAI, the Community Associations Institute. They got together with the ARRL and came up with some compromise language that a lot of hams say is too whitewashed and doesn't really mean anything, but I think does a pretty good job. We talked about that in a previous episode, covered that in great detail, so you can go back there and look at it if you want to see what my take on that was. But as a result of that compromise, it passed the House quickly in a non-controversial, you know, just quick run a whole bunch of things through in one day. And they were kind of hoping that would happen in the Senate. But there's a problem. And this is the problem. This is on QRZ.com, and it's posted by Frank, K4FMH, who calls himself some ham in Mississippi. And the reason for that is that that's, you know, somebody at the ARRL said that the reason we got the Parity Act into the Senate at all was that some ham in Mississippi convinced their senator, Senator Wicker, to introduce it, to introduce the legislation into the Senate. And he did. And it passed the committee that it started in and is now sitting before the whole Senate. Well, the guy that convinced his senator to do that is this guy, K4FMH, Frank. And he's been sort of sitting around saying, well, what's the problem? Why isn't it passing the Senate? And what he discovered, he talked to folks at his senator's office, and they say that a senator in Florida, Senator Nelson, has a hold on all telecommunications bills. And unless they allow those to move forward, the Parity Act ain't going no place. So what he's recommending is that the hams in Florida, because your senator's not going to pay attention to me because I live in North Carolina. Hams in Florida, alert, attention, hams in Florida, contact your senator, Senator Nelson, and say, Parity Act, let's get this through. So, what is the rest of the deal? Well, the best I've been able to figure out is, and I don't know who this is, this website, this NECA. I didn't spend a lot of time figuring out who they were. I just did some Googling until I came up with this. Here's the problem. Senator Nelson and some others are upset that the Republicans have not confirmed FCC Commissioner Jessica, I'm going to go with Rosenworcel. I hope I'm even close on pronouncing her name, to a second term. She's an FCC commissioner. She's completing her first term at the end of this year, and she'd been nominated for a second term. And evidently there was something of a deal between the Democrats and the Republicans to confirm a Republican member of the commission earlier this year, and then they would also confirm Jessica as a Democrat. And they confirmed the Republican, and the Republicans, I don't know if this part is true. The complaint is they reneged on the confirmation, and they have not confirmed her. So Senator Nelson is holding all telecommunications bills in abeyance until that happens, or next year, whichever comes first. But our little Amateur Radio Parity Act is sitting in that queue, and it's kind of stuck. So Florida hams, contact your senator. Senator Nelson, and see if you can at least get the Parity Act out of the deal. It's non-controversial. But then there's probably a lot of stuff in there that's non-controversial. And there may be lots of things behind all of this that I have no idea what they are. But this is what I've learned so far. Okay. Laura Smith at the FCC. There we go. Laura has been on leave from the Enforcement Bureau, from the Amateur Radio Enforcement Bureau, for a couple of years, it turns out. Didn't know. I looked over the ARRL's website, best I could, see if I could, do some searches and see if they've made any announcements about that. I'm pretty sure they knew. Pretty sure, you know, Dan Henderson, their regulatory guy, knew about this, and they didn't tell us. Didn't say anything about it. don't know why. There's still some enforcement going on. This is their list of some not a comprehensive listing of amateur radio enforcement actions. And it's two of them from 2016, a few from 2015, a bunch more from 2014. And this would be the territory that Laura Smith had been on leave from the Amateur Radio Enforcement Bureau. She'll tell you what she was doing. So it doesn't appear to have been a big deal, but then this is not anywhere near a comprehensive list. And as she'll explain later on in the program, most of what she does doesn't show up in public, and she'll tell you why. It's got something to do with lawyers. Okay, so no Laura Smith at the Enforcement Bureau for a couple of years, and so I suspect that that has had a dampening effect on some ham radio enforcement. She wasn't real specific about that. She wasn't at Dayton this year. She wasn't there last year. I got the impression it was still that budget thing, but maybe not, because she was able to get out to Pacificon, and I remember, I think her last talk was at Pacificon a couple of years ago. So it maybe not the budget thing. Maybe that's just that she was not doing ham radio enforcement, so why go to Dayton? Let's see. She talked about an online FCC complaint system. And this is what it looks like. I'll bring this back up again when she's talking about it. And I'm not going to go through the details now because she will go through it. But there is an online FCC complaint system now. She also talked about RFI. Noted that she's getting a lot of help and cooperation from the ARRL in handling RFI issues, particularly Mike Gruber. Shout out to Mike, W1MG, up at the ARRL lab. She said that now there have been lots of NALs, Notice of Apparent Liabilities, and monetary forfeiture orders. Can't talk about the specifics of those. Lawyers. It's going to remind us to stay away from problem frequencies. And the one I know about, that everyone knows about, is 14313. I guess there's a bunch of others, I guess. Apparently, hams have had a bad reputation among some FCC staff. Laura says it is an undeserved reputation, but it is among some staffers inside the FCC due to our usual few bad guys. And it was just a quick comment. You'll hear it, and I'll make note of it. You'll hear it, but, you know, She's going to talk about hams who have felony convictions. There are about 300 of them now. The FCC is sending letters to them. They have a ham license, but there's a problem with that. The FCC is sending letters to those 300 and going to ask them what their conviction was all about. Doesn't necessarily mean they are going to lose their license, although it could. And it also doesn't mean that they can't be on the air right now, because while this process is going on, they can be on the air. So you might actually see a processing hold of some kind on their license if you look them up. And you might say, well, you can't be on the air, but they can be. She'll tell you about that. The FCC is closing 11 field offices in January. Here's the headline that I probably should have put on this program, but I don't think it would generate the clickbait interest. The FCC and the ARRL are revamping the Official Observer program. The FCC is going to use OOs to assist in what she's calling first order investigation. They hope to roll this out as soon as this January. And the OOs will be listening, recording, sending information direct to Laura Smith. No, they won't be knocking on your door. Laura says there's been more aggressive policing in the ham bands. A New York unlicensed person, not a ham, got a $22,000 fine. He's now sitting in jail, cooling his heels. She thanks help from local hams. She noted that Bill Cross, W3TN, has retired. He did that a year or so ago. So she is then talking about the Wireless Bureau stuff. She finished the enforcement actions and is now talking about Wireless Bureau stuff that Bill Cross normally would talk about if he were still there. She said there's two current proceedings that you should be concerned about. One is the baud rate. That's FCC 16-96. The comment period is over. The reply period is over just about now, probably over by the time you see this. She says, and I was surprised to hear this, send comments anyway. You know, go to the comment section on the website, the FCC's website, and send comments anyway. They will be read. They will be considered, even though the official comment period is over. And she says this a couple of times on different things. So I didn't know about that. Until the FCC takes action on something, the comments could still have an effect. Please don't relitigate the code requirement issue in your comments about other things. So talk about that. Apparently, some hams, I have no trouble believing that some hams are still doing that. There are probably some of them that are still trying to relitigate, incentive licensing from 1967. It kind of died away. Sometime in the late 90s, early 2000s, hams stopped complaining about that. At least a lot. Every once in a while, raises its head. The other issue that she brought up, and this is one I was completely unaware of, is that there's a proposal to change a little bitty thing in the ULS, the Universal Uniform Something Licensing System, the ULS. It is FCC 15-40, and comments are completely closed on this one, but she said, file anyway. And the deal is, it would let a ham delete their home address and substitute a post office box. Putting a post office box or any place you can get mail is an okay thing to do. But if you had initially applied for a license or an upgrade or whatever and put your home address in, that became part of the record. And even though you changed it later to a post office box, anyone could still look up your old record and see that home address. And there's a few people that don't want to list their home addresses for one reason or another. Maybe they're a celebrity. A lot of women don't want to list their home address. Mine is there. Come on by, knock on the door. I don't care. But this would allow a ham to delete the home address, substitute it for a post office box, and the public record would lose the home address. It would still be in the regular record for the FCC to find, but the public record would be gone. She also says, yeah, there's plenty of old lookups on the internet that aren't going to go away just because we're doing that. So, you know, it's one of those things that won't have a lot of effect, but you could. And that finished the Wireless Bureau's regulation part of her talk, and then went on to Q&A, and the Q&A had some particularly interesting stuff. One of the first questions led to my title of this episode, Your Repeater, Your Rules. Someone is complaining about identification on a repeater, people not doing what the repeater owners want, and that's where she says, Your Repeater, Your Rules. Doesn't matter what the FCC's rules are. You can't go below the FCC's rules and require less, but you can require a little bit more. She also will say repeaters are not her favorite thing. Quite a quagmire that they don't like to wade into. Interesting, repeater owners. So that's why your repeater, your rules. Now, maybe it's because I'm kind of a repeater guy first and foremost that's meant a little bit more to me. A repeater owner was worried that the FCC could cite the repeater, the trustee, for the action of a mystery jammer, somebody who's evidently doing bad things on the repeater. And Laura replied that the FCC doesn't shut down your repeater for that. They go after the bad guy. That has not always been the FCC's policy. I remember in the past, Riley and maybe Bill Cross compared repeater operation to letting a stranger walk into your shack and operate. You know, work them through your repeater, sort of like letting someone come on in. And his advice was to boot them out. In other words, turn off the repeater. if they're misbehaving. Now, I actually argued with Riley about that. And I said, what that does is it just gives whoever the bad actor is on the repeater, it gives them the off switch. They know how to make you turn off the repeater just by being bad. And if the FCC is going to come after you because you left the repeater on when they did that, then gives them the power. We don't want to do that. There were other times when Riley stated it in a different way and pretty much came along with my reasoning. And I'm not sure whether I had that effect or I'm not sure about the timeline, but he had gone somewhat both ways. So it is good to hear that Laura is adopting this line of reasoning and that if you got somebody bad on your repeater, they're going to go after the bad guy, not you. Somebody asks what hams can do to prevent future bad hams from causing problems. Laura says, spin the dial. And I stick in a little bit of Riley's talk from 2007 that I put up on ARVN and titled One Big Knob. Put in a little bit of that. I'll give you a link to the whole thing if you want to watch it. It's a stand-up comedy routine. It's great. Somebody asks what the general process of an enforcement action is. And Laura gives a pretty darn good detailed step-by-step of the things they go through when there's an enforcement action. I'd never heard anyone go through that with quite such detail. There's a ham who makes a very heated comment about the lack of action on a fairly egregious jammer. He describes what the jammer had been doing since 1977. He gets mad. She says, it's okay. He can get mad. He's got a case. This is where Laura says, the lawyers have messed it up. It's harder to cancel a license today than it used to be because of court decisions. They also can't publish their letters of inquiry saying, we think you might have been a bad ham. Tell us all about it. We used to see those from Riley all the time. Reports are whatever that you violated these rules, explain yourself. We don't hear about those now. We only hear once things have reached some sort of conclusion. Notice of apparent liability type thing. And she says that she is still sending out tons of those letters of inquiry, but they are now considered an invasion of privacy. So, lawyers. Responding to a question, Laura notes that ham enforcement takes longer than enforcement in commercial or public safety by quite a bit. Commercial, she gives it about a week. If a business radio system is getting interfered with, she says it could take about a week. If it's public safety, police, fire, EMS, 24 hours. So, interesting. Hadn't heard anybody talk about that before. And finally, the FCC can confiscate equipment. The ham asking the question says repossess. Not really what he means. Confiscate equipment. She said it's easier to do if whoever is causing the problem doesn't have a license. Having a license confers some, not immunity, but some more rights to you and your equipment. They have to go through more steps if they're going to confiscate your equipment. She says the U.S. Marshals do the dirty work, that the FCC folks will tag along, but they don't go banging on the door. No FCC guns, I guess. Okay, see, lots of headlines. There was no way to summarize all that in one show title, so... Your repeater, your rule. Stop that. Okay, maybe it is a little clickbaity. All right, now let's hear it all. Here is FCC Special Counsel Laura Smith, who, by the way, did not announce that she got her ham license. No, apparently not. And she's not going to talk about that. Here's Laura.
We'll get the volume fixed and then we'll get started. How's that sound? All right, that better?
No.
Are you kidding? Oh, my gosh. All right, how about now? That better? Ooh, now I'm scared. Okay. Now we're going to move away from the mic. Okay, for those of you who don't know me, my name's Laura Smith, and I'm special counsel in the Enforcement Bureau at the FCC. And first and foremost, I want to thank all of you for being here. I'm sure you'd much rather be out shopping. And it's funny, I was upstairs and I saw some guys coming down the hall, and one turned to the other and said, well, at least we haven't bought a $10,000 radio. And I thought to myself as I was going down the hall, the day is young, the day is young. So I'm pretty sure that they're not going to get out of here without spending some money. That's just the way it is. Let me know if that's too loud on the mic. I can have them adjust it again. But I do want to thank all of you for being in here, and thank you for inviting me. I really appreciate it. As some of you may know, I've actually been absent from amateur radio enforcement for 2 years. I was put on a detail to serve as the regional counsel for the Northeast region. One of the interesting things about working in the government is they can kind of move people as they need them, and they had a shortage and they needed an attorney. So for 2 years, I've been working on proceedings in the Enforcement Bureau for the Northeast region. In June of this year, I returned to amateur radio enforcement, and I'm very happy to be back and very happy to be with the amateurs again. I'm glad to be here, and I'm glad to be back with the amateur radio enforcement. One of the things we did when I went back to amateur radio enforcement was we moved the position. For those of you that don't know, the position used to be as part of the field. I served as the special counsel in the field for amateur radio enforcement. We moved the position in June to the Spectrum Enforcement Division. This is the same division that Riley Hollingsworth worked in when he had this position. So it's kind of a homecoming. This is good for the amateurs, and it's good for the community because it does a couple of things. First, it gives me access, continuing access to the field, so I can use the engineers in the field on cases when we need to put them out there and have them do their work. The second thing is it gives us access to the attorneys and the engineers and the analysts in the Spectrum Enforcement Division. So if I need assistance or I need someone to help me out with this particular issue on a case, I can turn to the SED folks and ask for assistance. So it kind of broadens the base of people who I have access to on amateur radio enforcement. The other thing that we did when we moved this position to SED was the commission initiated an online complaint system. I'm sure some of you may have been aware of this already because you've filed complaints, but we have actually gone to filing everything electronically and online. This is very important for a couple of reasons. The first reason is that when you had filed your complaints previously with both me and with Riley, you would do it via the phone or on email or quite often via fax. That is potentially problematic because what happens if we lose it or it gets misplaced or if it's on the phone and we don't write it down? So there was always that potential of an issue out there that we would not have a case. It would just simply fall through the cracks. With this online system, that takes care of the problem. It is online. There is a record. It is an electronic record. It goes nowhere. In other words, it's there, so you always have a record of what you have filed. The second thing that's really important about this, come on in, there's more room over here if you guys need seats. The second thing that is important about this is it allows us to get to the case much quicker, which sounds kind of strange, but when you think about it, not so much. Previously, when you would call me or send me an email about a case, there was a lot of back and forth, a lot of, what do you mean, give me more details. With the online system, you're actually able to file anything and everything you need to right up front. You can file an electronic record. If you have recordings that you need to submit, you can do it right then and there, and it's very easy to do. If you need to elaborate, or if we need more information, the folks in our Consumer and Governmental Affairs Bureau who handle the online filings will come back to you and say, we thank you for filing. And it sounds like a generic response, but actually there's a person who's reading it on the other end. And they'll tell you, we need more information. Can you elaborate? What does this mean? So you're doing it right there. And that record is then saved into our online tracking system. It's not just on the front end. It's actually going into the Enforcement Bureau's tracking system. So what happens is it's assigned to me fairly quickly. Our people in CGB see the word amateur, and they immediately know, send it to me. And it comes, and it shows up on my to-do list. So when I go into our tracking system, it will assign it to me as a task. So right then and there, you know, it's making the loop and coming to me. And that's helpful because it gets it to me faster. Prior to this, had you filed it via paper or some other mechanism and it had not come to me immediately, it could have been anywhere. You know, we have 3,000 staff members, so it could have been anywhere and we would have had to search it in order to find it. So hopefully that will make things move along a lot quicker insofar as getting to them and getting you a response. It may not be the response you want. It may be I need more information or this is not actually a case that's actionable. But nevertheless, it is something that will get it to me in a better process. All right, so what's going on in amateur radio enforcement since I've returned? Now, I only returned to amateur radio enforcement in June, so it hasn't been that long. But since I have been back, we've been doing a couple of things. The first thing that I want to note is I get a lot of RFI cases. And those are, of course, interference to or from an amateur from either a utility or a neighbor. And with the neighbor, it could be any number of things. It could be a television. It could be lights. You know, I'm not sure if it's illegal in California for the grow lights and the growing of marijuana. I know, like, if we were in Colorado, I would say quite often it is the grow lights. not all the time, but quite often that's what it is. So what happens there is we collect the information. By we, I say it's a collaborative effort. What I have you do is to go to the ARRL. You don't have to be a member. This is a service that they offer in conjunction with the commission. And you provide them with the details up front. And those details could be the nature of the interference, a recording so that they can listen to it and figure out exactly what's going on. It could be more information from you. When does it happen? Is there a pattern? What are you hearing? Have you spoken to the neighbor? This information is actually collected by a specific person at the ARRL. His name is Mike Gruber, for those of you who don't know. Mike is actually an incredible person. He is one of their engineers in the field, in the lab there, and he does a remarkable job. He can actually listen to your recordings and determine what the nature of the noise is very quickly and efficiently. You send him an email at mgruber@arrl.org, and he will respond to you and collect the data. When he gets that data, he then sends a generic letter out to the neighbor, to the utility, to whomever it is, and says, basically, you're causing interference. This is the nature of it. We are the ARRL. We can help you try and find a solution to it. Please do what you can to correct it. Now, as most of you who have suffered from RFI know, quite often that doesn't do much. So when that doesn't do anything, he then sends it to the FCC, to me. And Mike does actually not file his cases in our online system. He files them directly with me. We have a system whereby he comes to me with these cases. And then we will go ahead and initiate an actual case within the FCC system, and I will begin sending out letters. In the event I don't get a response or the response is not something that is helpful, pound sand or it's not my fault or whatever the excuse may be, then we will refer it to the field, and that's where the relationship with the field comes into play. The agents will then schedule it as they can and go out and listen, determine if that is the source of the noise, and get it fixed. Now, as many of you know, part of the problem with RFI cases is that once you discover and resolve one source, there's quite often an underlying source that's completely different. And so it's very cyclical. It's not something that's going to be a one and done. You're going to have to do it over and over in order to get it resolved. But the process that we have in place is an incredibly efficient one with the league. So if you have an RFI issue, before filing it on our online complaint system, send an email to Mike Gruber at the league. Again, there's no fee. They do it as a result of an agreement they have with the commission. And you do not need to be a member of the league in order to do this. So go ahead and do that. File it with Mike, and he will collect the data and will initiate it. Right now in process, I have 8, which sounds like a fairly small number. But again, this is October. I got back to this in June. 8 is actually, you know, fairly high, all things considered. So if you do have one of these issues, please do not hesitate to go to Mike and see what we can do. One of the other things that I wanted to point out, in addition to RFI, was that I don't know if all of you have noticed, but the Commission has been very active in the past year in issuing NALs and forfeiture orders in the amateur arena. This year alone, we have issued over $60,000 in forfeiture orders in the amateur radio community against those amateurs who are operating outside the parameters of the rules, whether it be causing deliberate interference, playing music, making noise, any number of issues. We have levied a fine against them for their behavior. Now, I need to say this right up front. Yes, one of those has involved an actor in California. No, I cannot comment on it. So please, when we get to the question and answer session, do not stand up and say, oh, I have a question. Can I ask you about this case? The answer is I cannot answer it. So know that the case is ongoing. Know that the commission is aware of the other issues with respect to this, not just this case, but this issue. We recognize it's a larger issue, and we will continue our investigation into this matter. Sometimes, no, okay, maybe all the time, we don't get to it as quickly as you would like. But please understand we are working on it. We have not forgotten the issues, and we will resolve it ultimately. Which kind of leads me to my next issue, which is one of the things I tell people is I get a lot of complaints about, and we'll just call this guy Bob. Bob comes on and he's interfering or he's causing noise or he's just creating mayhem and violating the rules. So you get on there and you tell Bob, you know, you're violating the rules, stop it. You have just become part of the problem. So please don't do that. We are aware that there are bad neighborhoods in amateur radio. There are very specific frequencies that people get on and misbehave on. Generally speaking, they all kind of hover together, so that's good for us and that's good for you, because then you know you can avoid that neighborhood. Don't go there. Riley Hollingsworth used to use an example, and I'm going to share it today because I always found it very amusing. If you have three roads you can take to go to work each day, and you take the specific one every single day, and every single day you get a rock thrown at you through your windshield, after about the fifth or sixth time replacing your windshield, don't you think you would wise up and take one of the other two routes? That's the same sort of thing I'm asking you here today, is if you know a frequency is a problem frequency, don't go there. You have now become part of the problem instead of part of the solution. Get online, file the complaint, let us know about it. If it's one of the normal problem frequencies, we know. Well, thank you for sharing, but we'll tell you we know and we're looking into it. Don't take that as us brushing you off. That's us saying we know, we're looking into it. It takes time. We have short staff, which I will address in just a second. So we're getting to your issue and to your problem, and we know about the bad neighborhoods. Do not become part of this problem. You know, right now in our society, things are ugly enough, and if you don't believe me, I suggest you go turn on CNN or Fox News, and you will see ugly in a way that you just cannot imagine. Well, you can, because you've all seen it in the last year. Don't let that seep over into amateur radio. Don't become part of the ugliness that some people have decided to engage in on amateur radio. Walk away. Well, you know, you can turn your TV off. You don't have to listen to that same thing with amateur. Spin the dial, walk away. There's no need for you to destroy what is something that is longstanding, has a lot of respect, has done enormous good. I mean, look at what the amateurs are doing with Matthew. Don't allow that ugliness to seep into the rest of it. Isolate it. Don't be a part of it. Don't allow yourself to become a problem. Because you know what happens, and this is something I have spoken about in the past, what happens then is I come to know you. And you don't want me to know your call sign. The last thing you ever want for me to say is, hey, Bob, it's really good to see you, because that means I know Bob, and you don't want to be Bob. You never want me, you know, people come up and say, hi, I'm John, or I'm Pete, and they'll start to give me their call sign, and it's, nope, I don't want it, because if I know your call sign, and later on I recognize it, that's a bad thing. You want to be the bulk of the amateurs, which are the people who are abiding by the rules, who understand that the rules are important, who do what they can to move this industry forward. I mean, just think about it. I was watching all the scouts out here. We've got a whole bunch of young people out here working on some of their badges in amateur radio. That's amazing. That's the thing that amateur radio is known for, is facilitating the kind of new and exciting technologies and having young people, and hopefully we get more of them excited about being amateurs. You definitely don't want me to know you. You don't want to know me. I'm sorry, you just really don't. Anytime we have conversations. Now, if you're filing a complaint, that's entirely different. But if you're receiving the letter or the call or the email from me, it's usually not a bad, it's not a good thing, it's a bad thing. So let's avoid a relationship. Let's pretend that we're just casual strangers and we'll just sort of wave from a distance to one another and go about our business. And that means you're doing exactly what you need to do. Because the reality here is amateur radio is not a right. It's a privilege. And for those of you who are operating within the parameters of the rules, you understand that. And you are doing exactly what you should be doing. You are enjoying the privilege of operating amateur radio. Unfortunately, there's a group of people out there that believe it's a right. They believe that their egos trump, that they're more important, that what they have to say and what they want to do is more important than the rest of the 700,000 amateur radio licensees. And you just don't want to be a part of that. Avoid it at all costs. Their egos will get a short run in with me, and then they'll get online and they'll say that I'm curt and I'm rude and I'm mean and they hate me, and I'll be like, okay, next question. You know, the reality here is the less we know about each other, the better. Be part of the solution, not part of the problem. All right, moving along, now that I've lectured you guys long enough on that issue. and I do apologize, but it does bother me when we have amateurs out there who are misbehaving, when the bulk of you are incredible people. It's been a real joy to get to know so many people on a non-enforcement basis over the last 8 years. So I hate to think of the small number who are the bad apples who are poisoning it for the rest of you and giving you guys a reputation that is wholly undeserved within the agency. There's another thing going on in enforcement, and this is something that I kind of need to explain, so we'll go through it together. As many of you know, there are some people out there who are amateurs, and they may be in this room, who have felony convictions in their past. Now, most people say to me, well, there's no question on the form that references felony convictions, and that is true. There is no question on the amateur radio form in your application that references felony convictions. Nevertheless, there is a rule that relates to it, and it's in part one of the rules. Now, please understand, you are subject to part 97 of the rules, but funny thing, you're also subject to part one of the rules. It's not like an either or, it's actually an all. As licensees, you are subject to part one of the rules. And part one of the rules specifies that you have to have the character qualifications to be a licensee. It's actually part one, section 1.109 for those who are interested. I'm paraphrasing it, but that's okay. That's the substance of what it says. So if you have a felony conviction or you know of somebody and you have notified the commission, what we have done is put an enforcement hold on activity on their license. That means basically we have frozen them in place. They can't renew, they can't update, they can't get into another class if they wish to test and advance their class. They're on hold until the commission makes a formal determination as to what to, you know, whether or not they have the character qualifications to remain one of our licensees. There are a number of these people who are in this status. Approximately 300. But when you think of it, that seems like a lot, but when you think of that as a statistic compared to the 700,000 amateur radio licensees, that's a fairly small number. We understand that they've been on hold for a long time. So what we're doing right now is the Wireless Bureau is, as we speak, I got an email this morning letting me know that they're sending out letters to these people who have these convictions. They're asking them a series of questions. You know, what's the nature of the crime? How long ago? And it's a fairly comprehensive letter. These individuals will be responding back. If you are one of these individuals or you know one of these individuals and they receive a letter, advise them to respond. If you do not respond, your application or your pending upgrade or your pending renewal will be dismissed for failure to respond. That's just kind of the nature of it. If you don't respond, you're out. So if you have one of those situations or you know of someone, tell them, please respond. Be honest, be truthful, be forthright. The commission will then review this information and make a determination. This is an ongoing process. We sent out the first batch. We got some back for no address, not at this address I signed up. So it's going to be an ongoing process. It's not going to be a one and done. There are 300 of them. We need to give all of them an opportunity to respond. Then we have to look at and analyze their response. And the Wireless Bureau is handling this. This is actually not an Enforcement Bureau issue. This is a licensing issue, and the Wireless Bureau handles your licensing. So they will be reviewing these. For the rest of you, what does this mean? This means pretty much nothing, except if you come across somebody and you're looking them up on QRZ after you've had a conversation with them and you find that they have an enforcement hold placed because of their felony conviction for some other reason, that does not mean that they cannot operate. And in fact, quite the opposite. The rules very specifically state during the pendency of their application, they can indeed continue to operate just as they always have, as long as they continue to comply with the commission's rules. So for you, that means if you look them up and you see that, you just send them your card and go about your business. It doesn't mean that they cannot operate. So avoid getting into the back and forth of, well, you can't operate, well, you can. The reality is that they can. The rules say that. And they're doing exactly what they should be doing. And hopefully, if they get this letter, they will be responding to the FCC. And we will get this matter closed for them. And things will move on. All right. Let's talk about some things that you may have heard in the press recently. Yes, it is true that the FCC will be closing some offices. In January of 2017, the FCC will be closing 11 of its field offices. I was looking for the list here so I can read it to you. And I will read you the list of the 11 offices that will be closing. Some of them will be impacting your area. The offices that will be closing will be Anchorage, Buffalo, Detroit, Houston, Kansas City, Norfolk, Philadelphia, San Diego, San Juan, Seattle, and Tampa. There are 11 of them. Now, I know that that brings a lot of nervousness to people when we talk about closing offices and not having those field offices available to you, but a lot of good things have been happening in this during this process. And one of the things that has been happening that has been really helpful is that the field has reorganized itself. We currently have a new field director. His name is Charles Cooper. Charles came as, from our Los Angeles office. He was the district director out here in LA, or well, a little bit south of you, but nevertheless out from this area. He and his family moved to the Washington, D.C. area this summer, and he has taken over as the new director of the field. In addition, we have three new regional directors. The regions have been redistributed. Region 1 is essentially the East Coast. The new regional director for Region 1 is David Dombrowski. David was formerly our DD of our Philadelphia office. He's been with the commission for as long as I have. We started within a week of one another, so for about 25 years. And he's a great engineer. He was in Philadelphia, and he has recently moved to Columbia to head up Region 1. In Region 2, which is essentially South and the Midwest region, we have Ron Ramage. Ron was the district director of our Kansas City office, sorry. And he and his family moved to Atlanta, and he will be heading up Region 2 from Atlanta. In your region, and directly affecting you, is Lark Hadley. Lark comes to us from outside the commission. He has been very involved as a broadcast engineer, and he is a great guy. He will be stationed in our Los Angeles office and will serve as the regional director for Region 3. Now, there's no change in your local office here, San Francisco. David Hartshorn is still the DD in charge of that, and you cannot get a better guy than David. For those of you who have had the distinct pleasure to deal with Dave, you understand. We're talking about an enormous amount of experience and expertise. So that is not leaving. There are two closings that might affect you. That would be the San Diego office, but most of our agents are working now out of the LA office and our Seattle office, and we're doing some work with the Portland office to ensure that consistency remains. But remember, no matter what happens, the amateur community will go forward. You guys have a very strong community. You have solid rules. Those rules aren't going to change, and you guys have an incredible ability to self-police. And speaking of self-policing, I want to go on to the other area in which we're working to sort of ease some of the concerns about closing our field offices. And this is something that is very near and dear to me. This is a project that I'm going to be working on with the ARRL for the next several months, and it is a very important one. And this is the revamping of the OO program. As many of you know, the ARRL has a fabulous OO program currently in place. However, we're going to be redoing the entire program. They're going to be working in conjunction with the commission on this rewrite of the program, and we're going to use the OOs to assist us in the first order of investigations, because we are going to be short-staffed. When you close offices, unfortunately, there is a reduction in the workforce. And despite the efforts of moving the agents around, there will be a shortage. So we're going to step into that gap with the OO program. We actually have begun the process. We've had the first meeting. We are hoping to roll out the new OO program in January, and it is going to be an incredible one. Dan Henderson of the ARRL, in conjunction with myself and David Dombrowski, the Regional 1 director, as well as Chris Imlay and Riley Hollingsworth, an old and familiar face, are all going to be working on putting together a program where the OOs can serve as the first line of defense. What that means is they'll be listening and recording and providing me with that information directly. That will allow us to be more have a bigger handprint in the amateur radio community, because I'll be working more directly with the OOs and getting that information to the field so that we can follow up with investigations. Now, as I said, we're actually hoping to roll this out in January, so the next couple of months will be fairly intense. We'll be rewriting the OO manual. We will be working on the new group. There will be a whole new group of OOs that will come in that will be dealing specifically with this type of issue. So if this is something that interests you, certainly keep it in the back of your mind, and know that this is something that the commission views as an incredible asset. And the existing program as it is also an amazing asset. We just kind of need to expand that a little bit because of this shortage. The OOs are one of the most incredible group of volunteers that this community has. These are people who listen and send out cards, whether it's a violation or a good boy card. Either way, it's very, to me, it's one of the most incredible things that you have, because these are people who go out of their way. These people are volunteering their time and their energy to listen on the amateur radio frequencies, not necessarily to participate, and to help see that the bands are self-policed by amateurs. So we're going to expand on that. We're going to make it an incredible program. So please, if you're interested, let your ARRL directors know, because this is right now in the beginning stages of being worked on. The other one, I forgot when I was talking about enforcement, and it just came through my mind, so I'll just take it out of context and out of order. But one of the things that we're also doing a little more aggressively is policing your bands. I don't know if you all read that we recently had an individual in New York who was coming into the amateur radio bands who was unlicensed. He was operating and interfering with licensed amateurs, with broadcasters, with police. We worked with the ARRL, the amateur community in New York. We found this guy. We fined him $22,000, and he's currently sitting in jail. So we're very aggressively, we're very aggressively going after people who are coming into your frequencies that are not licensed. And I apologize for not raising that when I was talking earlier about enforcement actions. But just know that if you have a case like that where someone's coming in who's not licensed, make sure you get that information to us or to your ARRL directors. I cannot say enough good things about the guys in New York and the ARRL leadership there in New York who worked with us on this case. It was hand in glove, and it was a long and involved case, but nevertheless one that not only came to an end, but came to a successful end. So the individual is at this point not operating. Obviously, they don't give him radios in jail, and he'll be there for a while. So I'm hoping that we at least have some peace and quiet in that area for a little while, right till he gets out on bail, and then he starts up again. Normally, this would conclude my enforcement section, and then I would turn it over to Bill Cross to talk about what's going on in the wireless arena. As some of you may know, or maybe you don't know, Bill Cross actually retired from the FCC. We no longer have Bill Cross in wireless. This is a huge loss, both for the community and for the agency. I have to say, in all honesty, and I've known Bill a long, long, long time, almost 25 years, he knew more about amateur policy than many of us will ever learn in our lifetimes. And much of it he wrote, so he should have known it. but it was a huge loss. But now this is giving Bill some more free time to work on Islands on the Air. So for those of you who are involved in Islands on the Air, if you you contact Bill out there, tell him I said hi, and ask him to give me a call. I got a couple things I could use his assistance on in working on it. he's not taking my calls, just so you know. but there are some things that are going on in the Wireless Bureau that are relevant to the amateurs, and so I want to raise them with you so that you guys are aware of them and you get your comments on record. First and foremost, I cannot emphasize to you enough how critical it is that you do participate in rulemakings. You are a technically savvy and enthusiastic group of licensees. In fact, you're probably the most enthusiastic group we have. Sometimes that's good, sometimes not so good. But the reality here is you guys have things to say, and you're not afraid to say them. So please do not hesitate to participate. These are your rules. This is your service. What they do in Washington in rulemakings directly affects you. Do not sit quietly and anticipate that the ARRL or some other organization is going to represent your interests. While it is true, the league is one of the best, and they have some of the brightest minds. They got brightest minds, and then I was going to say Hollingsworth, and I thought that's probably not a good comparison. But they do have Riley working for them. They have Chris Imlay, who is an amazing attorney. They really do have a lot of very bright and intelligent people working for them and for you, but the reality is it's your service too. It's not just the league member or the league organizations. So you need to get involved and put your comments out there. There are two proceedings of particular interest to the amateurs that I think you guys should focus on. The first one, and I'm gonna give you the number in case you don't have it so you can look it up, is the rulemaking currently dealing with the baud rates, right? This is an important one for you guys. I think that a lot of amateurs have been filing comments on this. This is FCC 16-96. The original round of comments were due on October 3rd. Reply comments are due in November. However, if you have something to say on this, say it. Do not hesitate to say it, because if you don't say it and you don't like the way the rules come out, much like presidential elections, then you got nothing to say after the fact, right? So I suggest you do say something. Right now, there's a proposal put forth by the commission. Now, that doesn't mean it's cast in stone. That means it's a proposal. This is what they're thinking. This was based upon a proposal sent forth by the league, and this is to delete the baud rates, not to put in any bandwidth limitations, but to actually delete it. So the thinking on this is that this will encourage further innovations in the amateur radio bands. Now, that may not be the position that you advocate. You may think that's a bad idea. You may think that this will, in fact, become a free-for-all. People will begin transmitting data that you cannot interpret, because if you're on one end and they're on the other and you don't have the key to it, you can't. All you're hearing is static. That's what you're hearing. The two people communicating here what they need to hear, but you don't. So you think that's a bad thing. You think that's going to lead to misuse. You think that's going to lead to coded communications. You think that drug dealers are going to use it in order to do that. Whatever the thought may be, tell us. Now, don't just say it's going to be drug dealers using it. Come in with specific examples. If you have information that you know about why you think removing the limitation would be a bad idea, give that information to the Wireless Bureau. The one thing I tell people when you file comments, however, is be articulate. Sit down and write your comments out. I don't necessarily think filing the comments that are done in mass, where everybody says the exact same thing and they're just simply a copy of one another, are as helpful as you might think. You may think that that's just the sheer volume. Nevertheless, what happens is the commission sort of puts them in a bin. These are all the same comments. And what you have to say is not necessarily being heard as loudly as it would if you, in fact, filed your comments separately and put your own thoughts into it. Make sure when you file, however, that what you have to say is something that is relevant to this particular proceeding. Do not file in this proceeding and say, you know, amateur really sucks after you guys did away with the code. Don't do that. Don't file those comments, because that's not this proceeding. That proceeding is done. It's long done. We hear about that all the time. We'll have a proceeding ongoing and people will come and you destroyed amateur radio by, yeah, okay, but that's done. File your comments on this proceeding, be narrowly focused, be articulate, and be intelligent. You know, one of the things I get quite often when I get phone calls is I pick up the phone and people are screaming on the other end. I get that you're frustrated and angry, but you know what happened the instant I heard that? I turned it off. The commission and the people in wireless do the same thing, because if you file comments in which you're abusive or you're basically yelling, not necessarily, you know, they say typing in all caps. It's the same thing. If you're typing your comments in all caps, and you actually don't literally have to do that, but that comes through fairly quickly. If you're typing it and you're angry and what you're saying is simply a matter of getting your, venting your frustrations, your comments will not be taken legitimately. They then become sort of in the crazy pile. And you don't want to be in the crazy pile. That's where the guy with the tinfoil hat is. Don't be with the guy with the tinfoil hat. So when you come before us, make sure you have your comments laid out concisely and clearly. I know this is going to be a fairly contentious proceeding. We understand that up front. We know that there are two sides to this issue. We also know that both sides feel very passionately about this issue. We recognize that. Let that come through. Let your passion come through. Just make sure that it's not anger, that it's simply that you're passionate about this issue. The other potential one that you may want to file comments on has actually closed, but there's still the opportunity to file comments because it has not been acted on yet. And that's the one dealing with allowing amateurs to change their address in ULS to a post office box for fear of someone having their home address, and then removing that data from our ULS system on the front end, meaning that the public can no longer see it. What currently happens is when you file something in ULS, like a modification to update your address, if someone were to look at the past history of your license, even though you've changed to your new address, your old address still shows. And people are concerned about a potential invasion of privacy. We understand that. We get that quite often. That's one of the number one complaints we have about ULS. So the commission has proposed in FCC 15-40 to take that information offline, to allow you to file a modification application to update your address with a post office box or some other address that's not your home address, and that is perfectly allowable under the rules. You do not have to give us your home address. You have to give us an address where you can get mail. You must respond to commission inquiries, and you must be able to get mail from the commission. But that does not mean you have to give your home address. And then once you have updated that, your home address would then be removed from the system. Now, I understand that there are internet caches where people will be able to pull that information. That's the open internet item. Feel free to file comments there. You can be with the tinfoil hats on that one because that's where they all filed. So feel free to do that. But in this instance, there's not a lot we can do about that. If it's out there, it's out there in another format, whether it be at QRZ or one of the other online databases where they track information about amateur licensees. But it would not be on the ULS up front. That information would, however, remain visible to the FCC employees so that we can track the information as necessary. If we need your physical address, then there it is in our system for us to see. It's much like your FRN is available to us, or in some instances, your Social Security number. That is information that is not available to the public, but is available to the commission and its staff. Same principle. Yes, that proceeding has already closed as far as formal comments, but if you do have a comment to put on it, Scott Stone in the Wireless Bureau has said, please go ahead and file those comments. He was Bill's supervisor. He's the deputy chief of the policy division in wireless. He's the person upon whom all the amateur matters now has fallen. He is aware that there's been a long delay in getting this done, but since Bill deserted him, he now has to either do it himself or find somebody else to take over to do the amateur writing in the policy arena. So he is working actively to get things back on track and get that done. On that note, I will simply tell you that we're going to open it up for questions and answers, but before I do that, I wanted to tell you I have worked with the amateurs for almost 8 years now, and I have very rarely in my career met a more interesting and passionate and exciting group of licensees. You guys are amazing. For the small number who violate the rules, not so much. But for those of you who do what you need to do, who operate within the parameters of the rules, who are looking for ways to further this industry, to make amateur radio what it needs to be, which is an incredible and exciting, cutting-edge type of community, I thank all of you. You have made the last 8 years very exciting, very interesting, and for those who are violating the rules, very stressful. But nevertheless, it has been an incredible experience, and I do appreciate it. I'm very happy to be back among the amateurs and working with this community, and I look forward to moving amateur radio forward, because you know the magic of amateur radio is amazing. How often can you tell people you can bounce signals off the moon? I mean, that's really an awesome thing when you think about it, and that's something that you need to be out there telling those Boy Scouts. And if you haven't had a chance, they're wandering around, please say hi to them and encourage them. Welcome them into the community, make them part of it, because that's your future right there. So with that, I'm going to open it up to questions. I will remind you that there is a proceeding about which I cannot respond. So I know that there are people here who have concerns about that proceeding, and I understand that. You can see me after. I'll be around all day. So with that, I will take your question.
I have a question about the ULS rule change.
Yes.
Is it proposed that elimination of the address will be automatic and sort of blanket to everybody, or do you have to request that?
If your address is currently in there, then you would actually have to file a modification to change it to something else. So it's not like everybody, because we have to have an application that gives us a different address. So we can't just assign you something. You know what I'm saying? So there will be an upfront one that's available. It can be a post office box. It can be your UPS office where they have the mailboxes. Whatever it is, you can do that, but you actually have to physically file the mod to do that. And then once you've filed and it's granted, then it will be removed from public view, your physical address.
Automatically.
Automatically, yes.
So it covers everybody who did that.
Yes. Assuming the report and order comes out and doesn't change their mind. But as it is currently drafted, the commission's intent is to go ahead and do that. Yes.
Ron Simpson, S16KJ. We're dealing with an ongoing problem about some users who frequently get on a repeater and they don't think they have to use their call sign properly. I've gone over part 97, and you know, we have a protocol where we initiate contact. We give the call of the party we're calling, and they give our call sign. And it's not specified in the rules that that's how it's supposed to be done. And the rules only state that you have to use your call sign every 10 minutes and then close your QSO with the call sign. And it does start some arguments because people are expecting one thing, and you've got a small group of people that are doing it odd. And it sets a bad example for new hams coming in. Is there anything in part one that addresses that?
No, but here's an easy answer for you. Your repeater, your rules. The interesting thing about repeaters, and I will say up front, repeaters are not my favorite thing. They're from an enforcement standpoint, they really aren't. They're quite a quagmire that we never really do like to wade into. But understand this, your repeater, your rules. So if you say this is the way that we are going to communicate on my repeater, and you do not do so, then you can ban them from your repeater, and the commission will in fact support you in that. The rules do say that you have the right to close your repeater. You can even have an open repeater and not let somebody on because they're not following your rules, and the commission will support you in that. Yes, sir.
How do you become a volunteer?
For the OO program, you need to contact the ARRL. They administer the program. You might want to talk to your regional director here for the ARRL. I'm not sure where you're at, but whomever is your guy in the ARRL, speak to him. Understand that the program right now as it exists, the existing OO program will continue to operate until the new one is online. But if you are interested, make sure you contact the league. And they have on their website, they actually have an OO section that you can go to. Yes.
The easiest way is go through your section manager.
There you go. And there is a training manual. It's not simply I want to be an OO and tomorrow I'm an OO. There is actually a process in place, and that process will be changed slightly, but will certainly be part of the process going forward. Yes.
We had a jammer on our computer for a while. Finally, this stuff quit. Thank God. But if he ever comes back, how do we get rid of him?
Well, if he's jamming your repeater, you know who he is.
No.
Well, then you would file it, and then unfortunately you would file an online complaint with our new system. It's at fcc.gov. It's right there in the middle. It says file a complaint. And then it would be routed to me, and ultimately what I would do was have our monitoring station or our engineers listen and see if we can DF it. Unfortunately, though, it's not going to be a quick fix. It's going to take a little bit of time.
How is that going to, that's not going to end up getting us or our repeater in any trouble, is it?
No, why would your repeater be in trouble? Your repeater's done, assuming you're operating within the parameters of the rules.
Our repeater needs to be shut down because of this.
No, the FCC doesn't shut down your repeater for that. What they do is they go out and DF the signal of the interfering party and then go after. They either, at that point we monitor, sometimes we write them letters and that backs them off. But if that doesn't work, as we've done in the last year, we will fine you. That's something fairly new and very exciting, by the way, to get that many amateur radio fines out the door is really kind of a cool thing because there's a long and involved process to get these out. But we're in the business now of doing it, so we would be happy to. Yes?
What's the best thing that we can do to help the FCC deal with future issues of malicious interference?
Well, if it's not ongoing, there's not a lot we can do. You can't anticipate that Pete, or in this case, Bob, is going to be a bad actor. If I had a crystal ball and I could do that, trust me, I would show up 6 months in advance and take care of the problem because it's an enormous headache for me to have to deal with it. There really is no way except to avoid the problem frequencies and don't become part of the problem. You know, Riley used to love the spin the dial comment and everybody laughs about it, but the reality here is that's the best thing you can do.
This is just about a 40-year-old QST article, or QST magazine. Next to the last page is a big presentation on Swan equipment. How many of you remember Swan transceivers? Boy, they were the latest and greatest, weren't they? The Swan 500 and the Swan 50, well, let's take the 350. It has 12 little knobs and one big knob. So does the 500 and so does the 250. So then take this QST magazine about 40 years later. Let's look on the back. TS 570, it's got 46 little knobs, one big knob. And you look in the last page there, there's the 2000. And I remember last year I heard a guy behind me when I was looking at it saying, that's so big and pretty, I couldn't get that in the house unnoticed. I thought that was a good remark. By the way, if you ever hear that I'm dead, race to Gettysburg to my house because every piece of equipment in my house cost about $150. You can get some good deals. But this FT2000, this FT2000 has 75 little knobs, but it's still got one big knob right here. There's a reason for that.
Everybody laughs about it, but the reality here is that's the best thing you can do. Once we get programs like the OO program up and running, then we'll have better tools in order to monitor and listen, working with the amateur community on enforcement going forward. Yes, sir.
Laura, could you outline the general steps the FCC takes in an enforcement action? Toward that, let me give you kind of a hypothetical riff on. Consider the first step, somebody complains, and the last step is presumably a case in federal court. For a hypothetical, say the person in question to various communications either doesn't reply or says something along the lines, you have no jurisdiction, go away.
That sounds awfully familiar.
What's the general process?
Sure. Okay, we get a complaint and we investigate the complaint. And what that normally entails is we get the complaint, we review the facts of the complaint. Is it something that's potentially actionable? Now, and I say that, and people say to me, well, what does that mean if they're interfering, it's potentially actionable? And the answer is, well, it could be a one-off. It could be a content. Please don't file interference complaints on contest weekends, because that's a one and done, right? On the contest weekend, everybody's behaving like crazy lunatics. They're interfering with one another. And then it's over, and we all go back to being good people. I'm not going to find people on I'm not. Contest weekends are not going to be like big enforcement weekends. It's because it's one and done. So if it's not a one and done, then we usually communicate with the individual. We usually send first order as a letter of inquiry. We have received a complaint, 5 million complaints, whatever it is, about this behavior. Can you respond? Quite often we get, it's not me, pound sand, you have no jurisdiction, I don't like your shirt. I mean, seriously, there's all sorts of comments that we get. Some I'm not going to repeat. We get those back. And yeah, people actually do file those kind of comments with the commission, things that we just can't repeat in public. And you gotta wonder about somebody doing that. Once we get to that stage, then we go back to them with a warning letter. We review the facts, make sure that in fact there is something that is actionable here and that those facts are good. And our agents confirm that. Then we go back with a warning letter and we say, you're breaking the rules, stop. They either don't respond or they come back again and then they talk about my mother or, you know, any sorts of interesting things. And so then we go to the next stage, which is the NAL stage. At that stage, we send our agents out. We ask the local field office to go out and to listen, to record, to verify. They do their thing. At the end of the night or a couple nights, they get the knock on the door. This is my badge. This is who I am. I would like to inspect your station. So the guy knows at that point, yeah, they're after me and they've got me. So then the agents will go in and do their inspection. Then they will come back and they will propose either a notice of violation, which is kind of a warning letter, a little more serious, but kind of a warning letter, or an NAL, a notice of apparent liability. The lawyers will then go back and draft an NAL, which basically says, here's the series of facts. And we lay it out fairly coherently, because ultimately this is something, if they don't pay or they object, we will potentially end up in court over. So we lay the facts out as we have them. And the evidence that we have is then put into the file. And usually that evidence consists of things like recordings and video and notes, all of this done by the agents, and all of this is contained and kept by the commission in our files. We then issue the NAL, and they can either respond by saying, it's not me, I'm not going to pay the fine, or I am going to pay the fine, or they say, you have no jurisdiction and I hate you. So then at that stage, if they've paid the fine, we close the case. If they have not paid the fine, we issue a forfeiture order. And the forfeiture order basically says, we presented the case, you presented your opposing argument, we either agree with you and reduce it, or we don't agree with you and we uphold it. And at that point, as far as work, we enter it into our database as kind of a done, right? We've issued a forfeiture order, and so they have X amount of time, and the forfeiture order specifies within which to either file an appeal or pay. If they do neither, if they do not file an appeal, nor do they pay, we then put the little package together along with a memo and a summary of the case and all of the information, and we ship it over to the Department of Justice. And justice then takes a look at it. It's regionally, it's done by the local justice office. It's not done in DC. They then review the facts and look at the information and make a determination as to whether to go forward or not. Part of that analysis is, you know, their financial ability to pay. Part of that analysis is, have they, as the FCC, sufficiently made their case? Then justice makes a determination and comes back to us and says, this is what we've decided. If they take the case forward, then it goes to court and justice tries the case against the individual. And if justice wins, and the likelihood of that is fairly high, they're not going to take a case they think they're not going to win, then the court will render an opinion. And I'm not for closing on anything. I mean, when you go to court, that decision is up to the judge. It's not me or the FCC or justice. The judge gets to make that decision. But if the judge then rules in favor of the agency and justice, then what happens is your license, either you pay or your license is canceled. If you have anything pending while this is ongoing, however, we have this nifty thing called the red light rule. And the red light rule at the FCC means, once we have sent it on to justice, once we have closed our case, boom, and you have anything pending and you haven't paid us, we can dismiss your application. Dismiss it. So that's kind of the process in a nutshell. You certainly can appeal it from that point if you, not you individually, but you as the bad actor, feel that somehow you have rights that have been violated in some way. You can appeal it, but understand, you know, at that point, the courts traditionally lean very heavily on the agency, not just my agency, but any federal agency, because they are the people with the expertise. And so if they come in with all their files and all their information and all their affidavits from their agents and all of the underlying things, you know, the court's going to sort of view that and give it a little more weight than you might normally give it if it were just John Q. Public. Yes, sir.
I know you can't comment on this case, but I'd like to mouth off a little. Yes, sir. This particular jammer is using my voice and my call sign and voices and call signs of several people in this room to jam more than that. He's moving down. We moved our nets down to the extra class area. He does not license there. He's jamming there. And this has been going on since 1977. It's about time it takes some action.
No, you're entitled to be upset, and we understand that. We cannot, however, just cancel someone's license. Unfortunately, and I say this as an attorney and someone who's been practicing for 25 years, the lawyers have messed it up. The reason is, many people say back in the day, and the answer was yes, back in the day we could. The FCC had quite a lot more authority in that regard. They could come in and take licenses and do things like that. But then the lawyers took the agency to court, and the courts have said there is a process that you must go through. And unfortunately, it's just not as simple as, I get a lot of emails that say, can you cancel Pete's license? And the answer is, I would love to. There's many an instance where I would love to cancel. I don't like Pete. I think Pete's a bad actor, and I think we should just cancel his license, but I can't. And the reality, and this is really hard to hear, and I'm just going to say it front, I am sorry, right, for saying this, but the reality is, you don't want me to have the authority to cancel Pete's license, because I have bad days. And I come in, and my kids have made me furious, and I am looking to take it out. And Pete may not be a bad actor, but I am not in a good mood. And if I had the authority, I would cancel Pete's license like that. And I would go to my kids and say, this is what happens when you make mom mad. See what happened to Pete? So you don't want me to do that, okay? What you want is a process. I get that the process is drawn out, and I get that this is insane. There is no question, and all of the commission staff recognizes this, but we have no choice but to go through this. We have an Office of the General Counsel who monitors. I can't even publicize letters of inquiry. We used to put them out on the website, and I send out tons of those. And people say, what are you doing in enforcement? I'm writing letters every day, but I can't put that information out. Why? Because someone filed suit. Invasion of privacy. So there's nothing, you know, it's just the lawyers have messed it up. And I do it. And both myself and my husband are attorneys for the FCC, and we've managed to mess it up. So, and I apologize. And I do know. I really understand the frustration and the anger. I have heard the tapes. And let me tell you something. Everybody in my management has heard the tapes. And we are appalled at the things that are, there is no excuse. No excuse for some of the things that have been said to and about people. That is unconscionable. This is a classic example of what happens when something goes wrong. So please understand, we are as, we've had discussions where people have said, are you kidding? Did someone just say what I think they said? And the answer is yes. And that there's no excuse for it. So we are working on it. You had a question over here, yes.
I was curious to see if the process going after somebody who interfered in the amateur radio frequencies is the same with the process going after for somebody who's interfering in commercial.
No, it's actually different. And the reason it's different is that it's longer in amateur radio. You have me. We have almost 3,000 employees. You have me in the amateur radio community. And then the rest of them are working on other things, especially commercial and public safety. They also get immediate response.
Does the FCC prosecute directly people going after commercial?
Yes. If someone interferes with commercial frequencies, you'll get a response from the agency within a week. If you interfere with public safety, you get a response within 24 hours. Yeah. We take it very seriously. Guns and hoses. Yes.
Does the FCC have the ability to go and repossess a radio station if the guy...
It's called an in rem proceeding, and we do have the ability to do that. However, there's a process for that, and we have to go through... We actually have to file an affidavit through justice in order to do that, because what happens at that point is we activate the U.S. Marshals. We don't. We go out with, but we don't go out because we're not a police entity. We are simply a regulatory agency. And what happens is... you know, if you're operating illegally, and usually it's pirates that we go after because it's an operating illegally without a license. If you have a license, there's an administrative process that we have to go through. If you do not have a license, you do not have those rights. So it's pirates or people who are interfering with licensed frequencies like the guy in New York. And then we file an affidavit through justice. Then we go with the U.S. Marshals out and we take the equipment. We then keep the equipment for a period of time, and at the end of all of that time, assuming the judge hasn't decided to give, when we take it, we take as much as we can. So if you're a pirate radio guy, we come in, we take all your computers, et cetera. So you file a pleading with the court to get some of it back if it's not directly related to your violation. And then at the end of all of that, we destroy the equipment. We have what we call equipment beating parties where we take hammers and things. It's a great way to get your stress. I'm telling you, after a week of amateur radio enforcement, I'm out there kicking and beating. So yeah, so we do have it, and they're called in rem proceedings.
It's a shame to destroy that equipment when you can donate to somebody like the Boy Scouts or somebody who's not going to use it.
Well, some of it because of the software and things we can't. But if we, we haven't done an in rem in amateur in quite some time. We had thought about it recently, but have not done it. And if we did, that would be my first request to the front office would be, could we donate some of it? There's a lot of also museums and things out there who would be willing to take some of the older and more prestigious equipment. So I had a question over here in the back. Yes.
Yeah, hey Laura, this is Daryl, and awesome. We do have another talk starting in 5 minutes.
Yes. And just so you know, I'm here and I will move outside in the hall if any of you have questions or you want to talk, but I know that, can we take one more question because I got somebody in the back who had a hand. Yes.
You mentioned about enforcement officers with badges in the field.
Yes.
Now, I thought they no longer existed. How many are they
in the enforcement? Enforcing our field engineers? There are engineers in the field. I don't have an exact number for you. I do know the number that were being let go as a result of downsizing was 33. So we do have, the remaining offices are staffed, and I can get you a number, though, if you want me to get you an exact number of how many agents we have. Yes. But I'll be in the hall if you have questions.